Hello, folks. Welcome to the Nate Land Podcast. Still staying hello, folks. Until we do that, we're not in time. The rest, we're due hello, folks. It'll be a few more weeks. And then maybe the poll comes out.
Yeah. Oh, you doing some reverse psychology on us?
Well, you just don't know when it's going to come out. To Let's Go, folks. But Let's Go, folks, still is a part of us. Well, I do like the idea of you say hello, folks, when you're out in the wild and you got to go, let's go, folks, back.
Yeah.
People send us every let's go now. They send to us. And Mark Norman had a funny tweet.
Oh, yeah. Great
and
tweet.
And we got bombarded by it to the point where I'm like, all right, I'm just going to share it on social so people will know we've seen it.
Yeah.
But then they would see it on ours and still tag us in it. Yeah. They're like, hey, you guys seen this?
Yeah.
Yeah. You're looking at our page.
You're looking at our page. Yeah, well, I like to say we were the first of the trend.
Well, people gave you credit for
being
the first one to point that out.
The let's go is awful, and it's starting to catch on.
Mm-hmm.
So, good for us. We were first, Nate Land. All us folks were the first ones to do it.
Did you know that that's the University of West Virginia or West Virginia University? That's their legit slogan.
Has it always been?
I don't know. I got tagged in a bunch of stuff on Instagram. It's just West Virginia, let's go.
If they better hope they were before. If they were after. I mean, that's crazy. If they just go, that's a good one. Thank you to Talkspace. Talkspace is the number one online therapy platform that has thousands of licensed therapists trained in over 40 specialties. Needing help doesn't mean something's wrong with you. It means you're a human. Talkspace is there for you, matched with a licensed therapist. When you go to Talkspace.com, get $100 off your first month with the promo code Nate. That's $100 off when you use code Nate at Talkspace.com. Also, thank you to our good friends at Vuori for sponsoring this episode of Nate Land. Get yourself some of the most comfortable and versatile clothing on the planet at Vuori.com/Nate. Not only will you receive 20% off your first purchase, but you will enjoy free shipping on any U.S. orders over $75, Vuori.com/Nate. The Let's Go, did it say? How long has it been?
No, I didn't look.
We don't know.
No, I'll find out. Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, we do get, everybody says it. You know, and it's bad because it's like, I do get the idea of it in the sporting arena.
Yeah.
I do think it's like, I get it. But then it's like, it's just, it's crossed over. Now it's a wrap. Now it's done. I don't know who came up with it first. If they came up with it first, that's pretty impressive. And they could be like, no, we were the first.
Yeah. They've had it for a while because they have like branding guidelines listed on their website. I mean, it's a legit, they have a trademarked, let's go, trademark.
Wow. So they could be the first.
they could. Yeah, they could be owed a bunch of royalties from everybody using it.
I mean, they need to get that word out more to let everybody know that we were the first of the let's go. We started it.
Yeah.
Because now, if you go to one of those games, you go back, oh, no.
I'm going
to
find out when it was.
I did. Speaking of sporting events, so this weekend I went to, or this past week I did the St. Jude Classic of Golf. It was a pro-am that I did. And this pro-am is a world, I mean, not getting the weeds of it, no one, but it's because it was a WGC event. Usually you get to play with a pro. So it's like a celebrity and a pro plays with like two or three people. But this one we just did on our own. I played with a thing, which I believe we won.
Ah.
My group won.
Wow.
Won the scramble and beat Penny Hardaway's group.
Wow.
And they, I don't know if we got anything for it. We just left afterwards. They were supposed to have a dinner, and I feel like because of COVID, like stuff was just getting kind of weird. And so now you just win. And it was like, someone just goes, oh, thank y'all won. And that was it. That was the celebration. Oh, thank you guys won. That's cool. We get a trophy or something like you
don't. They don't even say congratulations.
They don't say congratulations.
Y'all won.
I said let's go, and I left, and that was it. Y'all won. Let's go. All right. I'll see you guys later.
Did you meet Penny?
I did not. I didn't even see him. I saw Michael Conley. Chris Lane was out there, country singer.
Yeah.
And I kind of know him. Colt Ford. But it was played in a good group, and then we went to Thursday. I went to the first round of the Memphis at the TPC Southwinds. And there's nothing better than a golf sporting event. I loved it. Me and Haley Joel Osment walked around. Haley Joel is in Sixth Sense and looks. He's just, his eyes look like the kid. Like, he's just like, I told him, because people just, we were walking, we went to go eat with Finau, Tony Finau. And so we were walking to go eat. And I just saw someone, they just looked at him and they go, that's that kid from that movie. What's his name? And I mean, they're just pointing at him and they're going, what's that movie? That's the kid from that movie. What's that movie? And like, he just keeps walking. It was like no acknowledgement. It was like you were staring at a sign.
Yeah.
And I had someone come up to say hello to me. The guys, Folk, listen to their podcast. I saw him, talked to him right after this happened. And, I asked, you know, Haley, I was like, do you even know? Because he's been famous since he was 5 or 6 years old. Mm-hmm. And I've been in one of the biggest movies ever.
Yeah.
And I was like, do you even realize it? He's like, oh, I don't. It's, you
By
know.
By the way, Forrest Gump before that.
Forrest Gump before that. Yeah. Oh, that's so crazy. So
two pretty big movies.
Yeah. I mean, two mega movies. Yeah. He was like, I'm just numb to it. He doesn't even know. Like, I don't even know if he realizes. I mean, he doesn't even remember A World Without Being Recognized.
How old is he now?
34.
Wow.
So, I mean, he doesn't, 80, I think he was born in 88, because he said he's a big Dodgers fan. He's a great guy. Big Dodgers fan. And that the year they won was the year he was born. And so
Kurt Gibson year.
Yeah. So, but like, yeah, it's funny to think. He's just never not been recognized. Mm-hmm. I mean, you don't really remember before you're 5. So, like, he just doesn't even know what it's like to not someone be like, oh,
yeah,
you're that.
It's almost like you notice if nobody did. You know, that would stand out.
That would stand out. Like, you know, I feel like you just go live your regular life. But anyway, so we walked around the tournament, and it was just so much fun. Going to a golfing event. I know I love golf, and I love it so much, but it's just – It's you know, you're walking around a nice course, and the dad energy at these golfing things is on full blast. It is the most, we are like children. Uh-huh. We will talk, it's the most we will talk to anybody. I talk to anybody, like I can usually go to some, like I'm like, I don't want to talk to anybody.
Yeah.
But at a golfing event, you're like, I'll talk to every, like, it's just dads walking. It looks like if you throw kids in a playground,
right?
And you're like, all right, I'm gonna come pick you up in like 3 hours, and you go, all right, I'll find someone to play with. That's how you could just throw me into a golfing event, and I'll start talking to, I'll be like, I'll walk around with some guys. Yeah. We met this one guy. We were, Haley was like, I want to get hit by a ball. And that was one of his goals, was hoping to get hit. Uh-huh. And we're walking up 17 hole, and we're standing there. And then this guy comes over and starts talking to us. And he was a member at that course. So he's telling us like kind of about the course. And we were like, so we talked to him. We walked around with that guy. We almost got hit too. Haley, a ball came right over by us right after he said it. And so then we all go, like, then we all just go run, and like, you know, you ever see the ball like go off to the side. We all just run over there and stand as close as we can. And we just sit there, we're like, we were all kind of giving our advice. We're talking to each other.
Yeah, what you
like,
would do.
Yeah, be like, he's got a little window right there. Just pop it up. Just pop it right through there. None of us can do this shot. Uh-huh. And we're telling him to do this shot. We had this other hole we were standing, and a ball goes into the water. So they have to mark where the ball went. Crossed the red line and went in the water. And I mean, just 50 dads would be like, no, over. Oh, yeah, right. Like, you know, just the idea of like the construction site where there's a hole, we just stick it. It is just that full blown of just, there you go. Yeah, he was right there. Like, we're a part of the game.
Right. Yeah.
But you think you are, at least.
Yeah. Well, you really are. I mean, he marks the ball where we tell him, really? Which is kind of funny to be just like, you're a, like where we go, it went out right there. So they have to, in golf, you kind of have to use the crowd, because there's times where the ball goes out. You're like, where did it cross? And you'd be like, well, it crossed right over me right here. So I was standing right here. But I mean, we're all rule followers. So we're not, And golf is a game of rule following. So we're very, like, I mean, it was an inch. It's basically like just in general, where did it go out? And we're like, no, there. And I mean, just everybody, just, you know, anybody. You're 30 to 80, we're just yelling at you. Man. It's just very funny. Like, I just thought, I was like, God, this is a grown man's playground. Mm-hmm.
Sounds great.
It's great.
Yeah.
It's just everybody's in there. Everybody's talking about what shot, what club to use right there. Ask me, what hole is this? It's 9. How's he doing? He's doing good. He had a little, you know, he missed a little short putt, but I think he's going to do good. And you're like, oh, that's good. Yeah. And then, I mean, just talk to everybody. It is amazing. So it was a fun, I loved it. I stayed till they kicked me out. I was watching these players go to the range after the round. They go hit at the range. I'm sitting there just watching the range. I'm like by myself. I had a couple of people like recognize me. They come up and they're like, hey, like, what are you? And I'm just alone. Like, just like, I'm just talking to them.
Haley Joel Osment left a while.
Haley Joel Osment, gone. Gone, by the way. I'm driving home. I mean, truly gone. They're done playing. The round is over. Mm-hmm. I'm watching. I ended up, and I fortunately got to know or met Webb Simpson as well. And so me and Webb have like, he came to a show once and we've only like text. And so I've never like truly officially met him. So I was kind of waiting to kind of meet him too. And so I got to talk to him, and he's the nicest guy ever. Him and Tony are both sweethearts. And so I got to talk to him. But it was just funny to be sitting there. Like, I'm watching one other grown man just hit balls at the range, not even playing.
Yeah.
Oh, I could watch them all. I watched them putt. And then they practice putting. It was cool to see them, what they do like after the round. I mean, I think it's cool. I don't, you know, other people would be, I mean, there's a group that loves it.
Yeah.
And we all love it. And there's just, it's very, very funny. I really enjoyed it.
Like, a little more info on the West Virginia's Let's Go. So how long would you say that this has been going on, that this has been a problem?
The Let's Go?
Yeah.
I would say in the past year, I guess. Yeah. Like,
I'll say six months, maybe.
So last fall, October of 2020, West Virginia sent Let's Go flags to all the incoming freshmen in the mail. And this is the earliest that I can find something. So they kind of got on board pretty early.
Pretty early. I would be able to see when it, you know, I feel like Tom Brady was one of the, well, what was the LF, you know, when people do LFG, mm-hmm. like they do hashtag, which is, I believe, a curse word.
Yeah.
But so when was that?
Well, let's find that. Yeah. I'll look it up.
Yeah.
We'll circle back.
I played with your dad in that charity golf tournament last fall, and John Chris was with us, and he said, let's go on every hole. So at least, well, last fall, people were saying it, or at least he was. Yeah. Maybe he was the first one, like he said. But
yeah, they don't. They're saying it as just a conversation. That's the one that's the problem. John Chris he's got a problem with it. Like, they don't. It's someone they don't know how to have any interaction. So they don't know what to. It's someone that doesn't know how to be a regular person, and so they just every 2 seconds. I have golf with Rich Day. Listen to this podcast. Rich's Let's Go every 2 seconds. He said it at the. She came to the show in Tupelo, and he Rich will say it because Rich knows now. He'll say it around me. Then he just looks at me, and I'm like, "Yeah, what are you doing?"
Well, I was about to ask you how you knew Tony Finau, just because he told us in Tupelo to. He hadn't mentioned me lately in the podcast.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So I'm just gonna slip him in.
I do know Tony because of Rich, but they say Let's Go. I mean, they don't even know they're saying it. That's when it's a problem. When you go, you know you're saying it a lot. They go, oh, I don't. I'm just like, I didn't know I say it.
It's like unbelievable.
It's like saying unbelievable. I say that a lot. Why is it? Yeah. See, but no one else is saying unbelievable that much. Just find your own weird thing.
Yeah. People were using LFG as a hashtag 5-6 years ago.
Yeah.
I feel like it got brought into the mainstream.
So it's been around.
It's been around.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can't pinpoint it. Yeah.
Can't find the genesis of it, but
go to get off of talking about Let's Go.
Yeah, I agree.
What? So
it made me feel like I'm the one.
No. I wasn't saying that. Speaking of, I'm going to keep it going. So I went to the Nashville Sounds game this week. Was invited. One of the folks, Doug Buckler, I think he's the pitching coach for Toledo Mudhens, and he's a big fan of the podcast. And he invited, I think he invited both of us, but you couldn't make it. Mm-hmm. Toledo was in town playing the Sounds. So he invited us to a game. So I went, he got me and my buddy and his family all tickets. We went down before the game. He was in the right field bullpen. I mean, I'm not even close to him. He lifts his hat and he's waving at me.
Yeah.
And we go down there and he was so nice, just super cool guy. And he got us all baseballs from the bullpen.
Oh, great.
And I gave him some Nateland merch.
Yeah.
He's probably like, okay, yeah. Great, buddy. Yeah, yeah. Way to go. But he was so nice. And he's just such a fun guy. He told us all these fun stories about doctoring the ball when he played baseball.
Yeah.
And on his hat, he does it just as a joke. He has like pine tar, like yeah. right here, just to mess with the umpires.
Yeah.
And there's a video of him when he played Major League Baseball for the Padres. He would sneak from the bullpen and steal people's beers from the stands.
Oh, yeah.
And there's like a viral video of him sneaking. And he kind of like sneaks on the wall at Mission Impossible and he steals a lady's beer and then he takes it to the bullpen. So he's just a fun character.
He's a fun guy.
Fun guy. So during the game's going on. He gets his great seats. He comes out of the dugout in between like the fifth and sixth inning, looks at me, gets my attention and goes, "Let's go."
Yeah.
And everybody like, why is the Toledo Mudhens coach yelling at this guy, yeah. you know, in the stands telling him to let's go. So
that's sitting there that you're, oh, how fun is
there
this
he is
guy?
Right there.
Yeah.
I mean, creeping up to the wall, reaching over, grabbing a beer.
How great is that?
This guy's awesome.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So that's he's really a fun cool. guy, big fan of the podcast.
And that's awesome, man.
Yeah.
That's so funny. He just cost those people $40 because he's got to go get it. They got to go buy a beer again. I mean, do you know those people are just like, that, I wonder if they probably got told. What if they didn't? And they're still just going, dude, that's something that you never probably let go of. You just go like, I swear to you, I went to a Padres game. I had a beer. Where could someone get it?
Yeah. And then, so my buddy's kids, they all had a baseball and they loved it. I mean, that's yeah. what's a great thing.
You have one too?
That's
what
I do.
That's what people see. You go walk down with a hat carrying stuff. And then they just see you get handed a ball, and you're like, just big smile on your face.
Yeah, I mean, I did. But he, so his kids, like, they had to go to the bathroom or something. Their mom was going to take them. And then dad was, my buddy Ben was like, just leave. You don't need to take the ball. Just leave it here.
Yeah.
And while this kid's gone, Ben's holding the ball. He drops it somehow, and it rolls down the stands, through the bleachers, all the way down to the bottom, and, like, underneath, like, a little kid's feet. And he had to go down there and like tell, like, I mean,
yeah.
you see that little the ball there? Can I have that back? It was just so funny that he almost lost his child's prized possession while he was in the bathroom. He had to tell another kid
yeah.
to give me that ball.
A grown man. Hey, kid. Those go viral.
Yeah.
When an adult won't give a kid a ball.
Uh-huh.
And it's not the good viral.
No.
It's the bad viral.
Yeah. Oh. Well, I told that Andrew Jones story on the sports episode where I got a ball,
yeah.
and then everybody started yelling, "Give it to the kid!"
Yeah,
and I was like, "I'm not. I am a kid at heart, and I'm yeah. keeping this.
Like, this means more to me than it would to that kid."
Yeah, that's what you said then.
Yeah,
I mean, I still have that baseball.
Yeah, that's so funny that you didn't give it to the
I feel kid. Like you're changing your stance now, but
I am now. Why didn't you give it to? I mean, I could see.
I don't know. Like I
now,
feel
you
like
got a ball.
I have a ball. I still have it. The point you made a year ago in the sports episode was that kid wouldn't remember that. He would have lost it in a matter of
he
time.
He would have, but the peer pressure is...
It was great, yeah. and thankfully it died down after a few innings.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you think if you're a kid, when I would go to the ballpark as a kid, I would go in with the mentality that I have to earn a foul ball. I have to go get it. What are we teaching these kids?
I think they're just getting it. But they run at it, the ball, and then you give the ball to the kid, and the kid just would come back and be like, I got it. Like, they don't think, yeah, no, are, I didn't just, I didn't
What are we teaching it. Them, though, dude?
Any means necessary.
Yeah, you get the ball. So I don't think as a kid, I'd imagine if you were a kid, you're not sitting there going, like, I didn't deserve it. You're not going to say, now keep it. I think they could look at Brian and they think something's wrong with him. And the dad goes, go get that. Go give him his ball back.
That's what you said a year ago. So you're consistent at least. Nothing's that's changed.
That's what I think everybody thought when they saw you go get this mud hen ball. They go, bless his heart. And they go look at him. And down. He's got his hat like just like that halfway up, you know, just like sits up and he goes, Brian just... He waves at him like Forrest Gump on the when the mud hen guy waves, the mud hen tips his hat and Brian's at the top waving real big and he goes down there and gives him gets his ball and bless his heart.
Yeah. I feel like a glove at a game. That's one of the things a kid does that as an adult you wish it was socially acceptable because.
Some people bring their gloves. I mean, a guy, they just showed a guy that I watched last night called a. But I think you got to be in a section that's like that. And you're like, we're going in the section where it's like, bring everybody's going to have a glove because they balls just get drilled up there. Hmm. If you're sitting a weird part and you got a glove, you're like, all right, dude, like you're in, you know, you're like, I don't even know where, like, you know, if you're like somewhat close behind home plate or something where you're like, dude, no. If you're behind the home plate, you got to catch it with your hands.
Right.
Because it's a foul ball. If you're in the outfield.
You mean, glove. How are you going to catch it behind home plate?
If it pops up.
Straight up and come down.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of them. That's what most do. But I feel like behind home plate, you got to be hands. Mm. You don't see gloves behind home plate. You're behind home plate. Mm-hmm. Outfield, third base maybe even, because it could be some rockets coming at you.
Yeah, yeah.
You can have some gloves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He said we should do a baseball episode, but he said do it in wintertime because that fit our podcast. Like when baseball season's not even happening.
Yeah.
So he gets
I think
us.
I have a mud hen shirt. I swear I do. And I don't even know where I got it. But because they're very popular. I went to Toledo.
Brett Kern, maybe he gave it to
you. Yeah. Did he? Oh, yeah.
Did he play at Toledo?
Yeah. He played at Toledo. But mud hens, because like AAA baseball's always got good names.
That's one of the classic minor league baseball teams, I feel like.
Yeah. Mud hens. Yeah, someone, Travis said, my tour manager, like he said something, someone had a weird, like there's a new name for some AAA team and it's real weird. And he was like, isn't that crazy? And I was like, I think that's what they do though. Mm-hmm. Their names are all kind of crazy.
Like, I remember when Montgomery... when we got the biscuits.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people were kind of embarrassed because it's so silly and over the top. And then, you know, Huntsville's got the trash pandas now. Mm-hmm.
That's what it was. He said the trash pandas. And mm-hmm. he was like, isn't that crazy? But I don't think he realized. I was like, no, I think that's what they do.
Yeah.
Which is actually the most creative.
Yeah. Might as well be silly and fun.
Yeah. 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 It's perfect. It kind of fits perfectly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I like it.
Kirby Puckett played for the Toledo Mud Hens.
Oh.
Yep.
Most famous twins. When I think of twins.
Yeah.
Did you ask him about...
Tony Gwynn?
Yeah.
He agreed.
He did?
Yeah.
Well, he played for him.
No, I didn't ask him.
You didn't? How did you not ask him? He played with him.
I think, he did play with him.
Yeah.
He was the setup man for Trevor Hoffman.
Oh, really?
Who has more saves than...
Yeah. Hall of Famer Trevor Hoffman.
Yep. His first, I know all about him because we talked for a while. His very first game he relieved.
It's not like going on in a AAA baseball game. I guess he's got time. Yeah,
it is kind of funny.
Did y'all lose? Did they lose?
A guy for Toledo hit three home runs in his first three at bat. He had three home runs after the fifth inning.
This weekend.
The game you were at. And I thought, I might see history here in the making. Mm-hmm. And Toledo still barely won 10-9. I mean, their pitching's terrible, but... I'm just joking.
Yeah.
They have no pitching.
Yeah.
It was a great game.
Or maybe their coach is too busy in the stands.
Yeah. Hanging out.
Yeah, hanging out. He's showing you around.
There was one time I was like, I'll let you get back to the. He's like, no, I got time. I'm fine. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
I'm going to go see him in September because I'm going to be in Louisville and the Mud Hens are playing the Louisville Bats. So I told him I'm going to come by and. Meet him then. So I'll ask him the Tony Gwynn question.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll get to the bottom of that, what he thinks.
Well, I say it correctly.
Say what?
Word it right.
Yeah, word it right.
Okay. Okay, I'll word it the way you thought you worded it.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. And so what else did you do?
Well, I got hacked this week on Facebook.
Yeah.
My Facebook's gone.
Yeah.
You don't want to talk about that?
Well, I'm trying to think if we need to do the comments first and then get into the... But you had a weekend.
I did. I did, man.
Just tragedy after tragedy.
What was the first tragedy?
Well, I know what's coming up. Because you have another tragedy.
Oh, yeah.
I got ahead of myself. Sorry.
Yeah.
I got hacked on Facebook.
Started off good with the game.
The game was great. Yeah. Facebook is gone, probably maybe permanently gone.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I'm hoping to get it back, but I don't – I mean, it's impossible to get a hold of anybody at Facebook. And
call 1-800-FACEBOOK.
Yeah. I feel like it's like a death in the family. You don't even – on Facebook much, are you?
No.
I love Facebook. I've been on it since 2008.
Yeah.
So I've got so many, like, just – pictures, stuff like that.
Yeah.
I think I'm the only one here that feels that way.
I'm on Facebook, but I don't check it really. I don't ever, like, you know, Instagram is the only one I'm.
Are you laughing because that's an old person's social media?
It's weird that it's become that because I remember when it was the cool thing to get. Yeah. I remember waiting till I was in high school so I could get one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And now it's these young kids, they don't even have Instagram. They're past Instagram now.
Yeah, they don't have, you know?
You're like three steps behind.
I've actually had, I've had it since 2008. So I've had friends who have died who I'm still friends with on Facebook.
Yeah.
And I think about their photos that I could still, it'll come up in memories and stuff like that on Facebook.
Oh, that's kind of nice.
Yeah. It is kind of nice. But now all that's gone because I can't refriend them.
They,
That's much sadder than I thought it was.
All right, Aaron. So, shouldn't have laughed so quick.
Tragedy after tragedy.
I'm just getting warmed up.
So, what, it got hacked and, like, did it send messages or something?
Like, I got up that morning and, like, had a weird message and then I couldn't log in. They changed my password, my email, my phone number.
Oh, they got in. Oh.
It's like, I can tell it happened like 2 a.m. and it's like Vietnamese, language now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So something will pop up and I'll have to go to Google Translate to see what it's saying.
Yeah. Your status. Yeah.
Your... Changing my status.
Did so if anybody gets a message from you in
Vietnamese.
Vietnamese.
Yeah.
It's not Brian.
It's not Brian.
At first it said Brian on. Brian and then the last name was A-N. And then by the middle of the day it was just completely gone.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
So I'm going to start over, I guess.
Yeah. Start from the beginning.
Yep.
All right. And then what was the other one?
Oh, man. I'm sorry.
Yesterday was a crazy travel day. I did a show last night at Calvary Church in Soderton, Pennsylvania, and it went great and super nice. Met a lot of folks there. Yeah. It was a lot of fun. But just getting there was a nightmare. All these flights are getting canceled, you know. And I was on my flight yesterday or on my plane, 720 flight, and the pilot comes on. We're sitting there about to take off, and he's like, "We've got a mechanical issue. We're calling someone in, so it's going to be a little bit delayed." And then he would kind of update us, and then at 8:20, he said, "Bad news, folks. The plane's been taken out of service."
Think he's a listener?
Did he say folks? Yeah.
Did he go, "Let's go"? He goes, "Let's go, folks."
Bad news, folks. Yeah.
Let's go, folks. Get
off
the plane.
Let's go, folks. Get off the plane.
So we had a D-board and then stand in line. And then I got through an American. And
did they say D-board? Is that how they say it?
D-plane, maybe?
D-plane.
D-plane. The plane, boss. What's that from? That's from
Fantasy Island.
Yeah, Fantasy Island. There's a comic, Bob Kubota. I think he does the joke because he says he looks like that guy.
Anyway, I got through an American. Got a.
Did
much...
you say that we got a deboard? Did he say we have to deboard? And they're like, what?
Deboard.
Deboard. Do we get a deboard? Hmm. I don't think they say deboard.
But they say deplane, don't they? I said deboard. I guess that's not a word.
I feel like you don't need a word for it. They can just say, "We got to get off the
plane." We got to get off the plane.
Yeah.
I think that's what they say. Uh-huh. Yeah.
So you had to get off,
Off the plane, yep. And then I got through to American and then I had a much later flight. So I ended up going home and taking a shower, getting ready for the show because I thought I'm going to have to go straight there. Went back to the airport and this was a direct flight and got there, rented a car, drove about an hour to my location and got there just in time for the show.
Wow.
And did it. Show was great. And then flew back early this morning.
Yeah.
Man.
Just a long day.
It's so funny because I came away this weekend with the I was on a flight this morning and I was like, air travel is amazing.
Yeah.
And we take it for granted. Not to sound cheesy, but when you think about that, Brian was in Pennsylvania
this morning.
I was in New York State this morning. Mm-hmm. And now we're all here.
Yeah.
This were 100 years ago. We'd never seen each other ever again.
Ever again.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's crazy.
100 years ago? 1920s?
Yeah.
We would just be lost forever.
Could be.
What would you do?
Yeah.
How would you get back?
I mean, there had cars by the 1920s.
Yeah, but driving a car from New York to a week.
Hitchhiking a Model T all the way back to Nashville? There is a slim chance. I think you'd give up. Yeah. Yeah, you'd just start a new life in Pittsburgh.
We'd have to record the podcast on Wednesdays. There's just no way you could get back by Monday. I mean,
you just start a new life.
These podcasts couldn't even come out on Wednesdays. I'd have a different co-host every week and go, Brian didn't make it over the peak of the mountain.
I take a train.
I got sad news, folks. Breakfast didn't make it. His horse tumbled down a ravine. How you say it?
Yeah.
And he fell off the mountain. and Aaron started a new life. Just got a telegram. If you guys been wondering where he's been the past 3 months, the telegram finally got here. Reads, I'm not going to make it. Stop. And that's how we get the information.
Yeah.
All right. Did you have something or you?
I took the subway for the first time in my life.
Oh, there you go.
It was pretty amazing.
Yeah.
I took it going the wrong way at like 1 or 2 in the morning. Went the wrong way. I was in an empty train. I thought it was so much fun. I took a picture of myself. Mm-hmm. I was like, this is hilarious. And then I'm in the Bronx by accident. Wow. Yeah. So I had to hop around, go to the other side and come back. I figured it out. Felt like a real New Yorker.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's a good feeling. Once you understand how it works, you're like, oh, this is pretty sweet.
Yeah, yeah.
You can just kind of hop around places super easily.
Yeah, it's Subway. Good stories, guys.
I thought I had some good stories.
Yeah.
Tales of Costanza.
I'm trying to balance out the horror of Brian's life by just like, let's find joy in little things.
Little things. Subway is crazy when you first take it.
That's fair.
All right, comments. Jared Taft, Nate Aaron, and Bench Press. What a missed opportunity for you guys to talk about The Office's Olympic episode. Instead, you managed to fit in topics like the Olsen twins, Fantastic Four, and Drunk Superman. The episode was definitely a hit, and I appreciate Nate bringing it. Had me laughing the entire time. Thanks. He gets it. Jared Taft, that's me. Paul Flanagan, I was driving. I just had to take a swig of water when Nate said the Cosby Show in response to Beanbag's question of what they bring back in 1,500 years. I was choking and trying not to crash. I was laughing so hard. We'll bring it back?
Yeah.
Someone said, let's go.
Let's go with the Cosby Show.
Like, it'll go away in 1,500 years. It'll come back. Yeah.
Let's go. C-Wade 828. My daughter, Hadassah Grace came out of her room laughing so hard she could barely breathe. When I asked her what was going on, all I could make out in between gasps was Jesus swimming in Olympics sandals. Thank you guys for creating a podcast that we both can enjoy and share. That's very nice.
It is.
Yeah. I like that she gasped.
She gasped. She's a gasper.
Mm-hmm.
Between gasps. If y'all saw each other, y'all just gasp back and forth. Is that how y'all talk to each other? Did you gasp when you saw the subway?
I did give a wow.
Wow. It's crazy.
You can have those little moments.
Yeah. You get COVID? You have it? You got it on the subway? I think it's breeding ground.
It felt like it in some places.
Maybe it wasn't a good sign that you're on it alone. All right. Holly's had enough.
She didn't like that comment.
At KF Richards, I thought long and hard about Bubba Fett's question as to what Olympic sport would I do as an undercover agent. I decided on speed walking.
Ooh.
I didn't know that was one. Seems simple enough, and quite frankly, I found myself doing the same walk while in need of a bathroom. Speed walking is a sport?
Yeah, it's an Olympic sport.
Wow.
And we'll show you a little bit what it looks like. It is kind of silly looking.
Yeah.
If you've never seen it before.
Yeah.
These are the best speed walkers in the world, right?
In the world. I guess just how long they can do it. Is there a lot of like slow it down, like a lot of whistling just to be like you start running a little bit?
See, this guy, they look like they're running.
This is the one guy he goes, man, it's a new world record. You go, oh, yeah, I guess it's called jogging because I was speed walking the whole time, but I guess they're making a big fight. You know, you were jogging around turn 8 and 10. You didn't step it up a little bit. What's the difference?
I think a rule is you're not supposed to be able to.
You can't have both feet off the ground at the same time. So there can only be 1 foot in the air. That's the technical definition of walking.
I'll be honest with you. That's a pretty good rule.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good.
Yeah.
Who's enforcing that? Somebody's down at ground level looking like up, up.
Well, the guy on a motorcycle.
Well, this looks like such a makeshift course. They just threw some cones out here. They don't even give them. It's like they forgot they had the walking event.
Well, what they should hold it in a mall. And that's a big miss by them. That's a big miss by the Olympics. How do you not just have
it in the mall? So many corporate sponsors right there in the mall?
I mean, how do you not have it in the mall? Yeah. And then you have the mall just be open.
So there are other customers just walking around.
I mean, it's just a regular, like people are going in and out of stores and you get, yep, I'm right. And just going, that guy gets around that turn. I mean, the hard part is how do you ever even catch someone? Like you feel like you're like, once it's set, it's set. You're like, well, that's it. They could just go. All right, done.
Oh, this guy's making a move. Oh, he's getting a drink of water.
He went over and got something. Even though, yeah.
I mean, when it comes to finish line, don't you just try to run just to see if nobody catches you?
Yeah.
This is a sport that's interesting to me. I mean, are there high school teams with speed walking programs? How do you get into this?
These are pretty young. I mean, you know.
The best of the best.
It would be great if you just had one, just the lead is just this 85-year-old lady. And you're like, this is what I do. This is what I do. Amazing. What time was this race? 6 a.m.?
that was the 2016 Olympics.
This is a 20-kilometer. Do y'all do that? I immediately change kilometer to mile in my head, even though it's not exactly the same.
I didn't even know it was close. So.
Yeah.
I mean, it's about the same.
I don't even try. Towel under the door. Freestyle is the name of the stroke, boys. You can't just do whatever you want. Bless your heart. It's the name of the stroke is freestyle. Why'd you call it freestyle?
I know.
I think you should be able to do whatever you want. I always think you can do whatever you want, and freestyle is the fastest. And that's why they choose that.
I think that this person's wrong about this.
Oh.
I think that freestyle, when it's a freestyle competition, they just put limitations on the strokes that you can do.
Yeah.
Now, there's a type of stroke that's the fastest that's called the freestyle stroke. People call it that, but you can do whatever you want.
But does everyone do that stroke?
Yeah, because it's the fastest one.
Yeah.
So I'll challenge you on that.
Okay, yeah. So you're saying they call freestyle stroke this because you're both kind of right. So you're saying that stroke is really not called freestyle, but it's freestyle because it's like it's the quickest, so we just call it freestyle.
Yeah, because it's the one everybody does because it is the fastest.
Yeah,
fastest one.
But if someone wanted to butterfly, if some guy just dove in and was like, "I'm gonna try to get all the way,"
I think they have some limitations. I think they don't let you do some of them for some reason.
So, like we said, so it's not freestyle. When that's what you would tell them. They go, well, you can't do that the whole time. You go, so it's not freestyle. Just say that. Franz 0589, I love how you guys contemplate things like, do they have soccer in the Olympics? And instead of looking up on a laptop that's in front of you, you just ponder it and then drop the subject.
I looked into it, and they do not have soccer.
That's crazy.
Stop, dude. It's just like Tom Brady from the week before.
We really dropped the ball on that one.
Well, I mean, it was at the end of the podcast, so we'd stop looking. As soon as we got done, Tristan said, there is soccer in the Olympics. And I tried to cut it off the pass. I even put in the description of the show, we debate, is there soccer in the Olympics? Incorrectly. And I put, there is. But no one read the description. So.
Yeah.
Do you know who won the gold medal?
Did the women, or did they lose?
The women won the gold medal. They beat France.
The women Olympic team?
I thought you were going to say a country, and you said the women.
Well, I meant the women of America. Yeah, like,
they got bronze, right?
They got a bronze.
Yeah, that's right. And then who won? Did men win gold? No.
We weren't even in the Olympics.
I just like the idea of the Olympics. It's like America. There's just a team called women.
Well, I meant like women. Women. Soccer is the only soccer you even know about. Like, yeah. So we didn't win. We got bronze. We should have won. We're usually the best team in women, right?
I think we lost like day one.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Amber Lotus. Oh, Lord, Nate. A folk corrected your misinformation and you followed it with more misinformation. Antibiotic resistance is not people being resistant to taking antibiotics, you goofball. It's how bacteria and superbugs are becoming resistant to antibiotics because they're overprescribed and people take them when they shouldn't, and the bacteria develop the ability to kill the drug instead of vice versa. I didn't understand that whole sentence.
Well, yeah. Somebody will probably correct us about what we say about it this week. It'll just keep going every week.
Yeah, I don't even understand.
Well, I can't remember.
I'd need to go read that sentence in a room alone.
Just take your time with
it. I would need everybody to get out of here and like, and I'd need to read it when I'm ready. Like I would have to, it's not right now. And I would be like, I'm not ready. You can't, don't bring that in. And then I would tell you, I'm ready, bring it. And then I would sit down.
So last week we read a comment about penicillin. Mm-hmm. See, I can't remember now myself, about viruses. And I'm just going to make it worse because I can't remember. But we were correcting one mistake. And then you said that's not the reason people are being resistant to taking it because of. Mm-hmm. But she was talking about antibiotic, how you build up resistance if you take too many antibiotics.
Yeah.
And we got a few comments. I chose this one because she called you a goofball, which that's an old school. I don't feel like that's used enough.
Yeah. So. Goofball.
You know what's a good one? Blockhead.
Blockhead.
Yeah. Yeah. Doesn't that sound good?
Yeah. Blockhead.
I'm going to bring it back.
Yeah. Mm. Well, let's go. Luke Harder. Winter Olympics are just as hyped as Summer Olympics. It depends on where you're located in the U.S. I grew up in Minnesota, and the Winter Olympics were way more important to us than the Summer Olympics. It's a good point. Good point, Luke.
I think I made that point last week.
I doubt it. Eric Ed Adam and Adamson. Adams, Eric Adamson. That's it.
Yeah.
If you lined up all of the words that Nate can't pronounce, it would stretch a quarter of the way across Rhode Island.
Ooh.
Probably.
That's good.
It's good. Blockhead. I don't know if I like blockhead.
Oh, yeah. It's got a.
It's you're too
gonna,
clunky.
Now you're going to come across a situation where it'll sound good. I believe. Yeah, I believe in it.
Tiffany Sadler, Tiffany with an E. Tiffany. Why was it? Is she really Tiffany?
I mean, that's how it's spelled.
Yeah. Huh. I've never heard of Tiffany. Have you ever met a Tiffany with an E?
No.
I mean, if her parents did that to her, they just her whole life is no. I mean that.
Hey, do you mean Tiffany?
No. Yeah. I mean, that'd be most of her life would be talking about that. Mm-hmm. It's like Teflar. Tiffany. Huh.
Teflon?
Just call me Sadler. I just saw the show at the arena in Tupelo and loved it. Nate's new material is great. I was shocked and amazed at Bryce and his stage presence. He is actually funny.
Thank you.
He seemed so socially awkward on the podcast. I was pleasantly surprised. Well, you didn't see the full hour, Tiffany.
Yeah. Thank you, Tiffany. That was very sweet.
The church in Pennsylvania, they saw the whole thing. They begged to differ. That was a fun show. Tupelo.
Yeah.
Sarah Meesh. I was dying when Nate was talking about going out to the pitcher with no information. Recently at my 9-year-old nephew's game, he went out to calm down the pitcher who had started crying. Later we asked what he said to encourage him. All he had said was, "You're crying," and walked back to home plate. That's wonderful. Wonderful. That's so funny. But I love it. I mean, 9-year-old seeing him out there just starting crying. It's the greatest thing ever. Like kids, like their emotions. And it's funny when you see kids because kids don't greet each other. Have I talked about that on this? I don't know. But like they don't, I can do this as a joke. They don't greet each other. Like, you kids are very, you'd be like, "Oh, that's your friend from school." And they just go, and they just walk by them. Mm-hmm. Like, they don't, you know, like, if we saw each other, like, out kind of out of context of, you'd be like, what are you doing here? Mm-hmm. Like, you'd have some kind of, and a kid, you're like, oh, look at that. That's crazy. They're there.
They don't shake hands.
They don't shake hands. There's no acknowledgement. And if they saw, like, there's no, like, if my daughter saw my niece, her cousin, and they're very close, and if my daughter saw her at the Tupelo show randomly, it wouldn't be like, what are you doing here? They would just be like, oh, Maya, hi, come back here. And then they would just act like it's normal that they're all there.
Man, that's interesting.
And there's no like, what are you doing here? Why would you be? That's crazy. And then you go have a normal.
Yeah.
It's very funny. Kids just are like, I mean, I feel like they're just, anything can happen. They're just like, yeah, yeah.
They're along for the ride. So they're along for it.
They're like, yeah, they could. Why would they not be here?
Yeah.
Nathaniel Garwick. As a fellow Nathaniel, I signed my name Nate in school. One time our teacher got very upset at someone who signed their name. They signed their name at the top of an essay and asked the culprit to fess up. After 10 minutes of heated silence, the entire class had to write a second essay as a punishment because the idiot wouldn't fess up. I got out some paper and started writing the new essay. As I sat there thinking of how stupid you'd have to be to write name instead of your name, I glanced at the top of my new paper and saw name. I was the stupid idiot. I accidentally wrote name instead of Nate. Never told anyone. Did it several more times. Just felt like that might be comforting to Nate. That's very funny.
Yeah.
That they had to do it. Yeah.
My favorite part of that is, did it several more times.
Several, yeah. I'll be honest with you, never caught on. It just kept hurting it. And then they do it. All right. Talk space. Trying to balance work, home, relationships, and everything else. It's challenging for everyone. And because now more than ever, it's a good idea to seek out a little extra help for our busy, demanding lives. I feel like life is coming at you very fast. Therapy can help you shift your outlook, be more positive, and find tools to cope in the difficult times. A great thing with Talkspace, it is very affordable, and that is usually what stops people from talking to someone. Talkspace is a fraction of the cost of in-person therapy. Instead of waiting for an appointment, you can send and receive unlimited messages to your therapist 24/7, and they will respond to you daily, 5 days a week. Talkspace is very secure and private since they use the latest encryption technology to store client information. No one's going to find your information. Also, you can start filling with, I mean, just a single message. I do think it's very good if you're sitting there listening to this and you do want to talk to someone, and it could be embarrassing. You could be like, I don't know if I should. You do this very private. It's not a bad thing to talk to someone. Match with a licensed therapist when you go to talkspace.com. Get $100 off your first month with promo code Nate. That's $100 off when you use code Nate at talkspace.com. Also, Vuori. Vuori is a new outlook on performance apparel, perfect if you're sick and tired of traditional old workout gear. I have the Sunday performance joggers, which are very comfortable. I wear them all the time. Just wear them around the house. They're great, but they also look very good. I think I want to start wearing them when I travel. Mm-hmm. I think they look good traveling. I always think with traveling, you don't want to look like just a mess. And I feel like now you can wear some very comfortable clothes that looks kind of like hip. Also, I got new core shorts that I actually worked out in this morning. I've been working out, and we work out outside. It's very hot. They were super light, which was very nice. And, you know, because it was very, very hot this morning. And I mean, I just wore them. They were awesome, super comfortable. Everything is designed to work out in, but does not look or feel like it. So you can wear it at any point. They make it look so great in everyday life, not only in the gym. So many people are still working from home. So with the Vuori, you can look nice, feel great, and run errands. Ordering online is very easy. The website is not cluttered. It looks good. Very easy to pick your stuff out. I went and I picked it out. Everybody should know it's easy. If I can do it, if I can get through it and do it, then you can do it. I promise. Vuori is an investment in your happiness. For our listeners, they are offering 20% off your first purchase. Get yourself some of the most comfortable and versatile clothing on the planet at Vuori.com/Nate. That is Vuori.com/Nate. And you will receive 20% off your first purchase, but also enjoy free shipping on any U.S. orders over $75 and free returns. So go to Vuori.com/Nate and discover Vuori clothing like I did, like we all did. One, two thing before we get into the topic, I wanted like a random, my brother is big into golf. I'm soccer. So Messi, Lionel Messi, is leaving Barcelona. If you don't know anything about soccer, it's a big deal. I don't know much about soccer, but I know Messi is kind of a once in a lifetime kind of thing, and and it's the biggest sport ever. He signed with Barcelona, I believe, at 13, and they signed his contract on a napkin.
Wow.
I was thinking about it. This could be the greatest sports in the history of all sports, the greatest, what would you call that, asset or the greatest move or whatever that you ever could do.
Investment.
Yeah.
It ever been
it's
done.
A gamble, for sure. Yeah.
13 years old.
How old is he now?
34.
Wow.
Or 33 or 34. And then same as Haley Joel Osment, born when the Dodgers. I think he was born in 87.
Yeah.
But you got him when they saw him at 13. I like kind of looked it up. I wanted to watch a documentary. It's kind of crazy. Like they see him and he was very small. He had to take growth hormones. He's not a big guy. And he was even smaller than that. So it was a big risk just being like, he was out there and you're like, well, he looks like he's way younger.
Yeah.
And then they saw when he dribbled and they go, well, he's a phenomenon. And they've never seen anybody touch the ball like that. And they just thought, Barcelona was like, well, we need to get him before other people realize how good he is. And the dad, I think his dad was like, I don't know, whatever. And they go, they just grabbed a napkin and they said, you are, and they wrote a contract out on the napkin. And as Derek, my brother, said, the napkin's in a safe now. But it's, people say he's the greatest of all time. 13, you lock him up for 20 years. Yeah. And now he's leaving. The money didn't work out or something. I think they're leaving very mutually. Like, it just, he deserves to get, he's taking pay cuts. I don't know so much about it, but it seems like he's taking pay cuts before, but he deserves a big payday now. They just can't afford it. And he was crying when he left. He didn't want to leave.
I saw that, yeah.
But man.
That's crazy.
How crazy is that? How smart? I mean, that guy, instant, just to pick that up, and you're like, yo, we got to get this guy.
How old was he when he became a star?
I mean, he started becoming then, 13, then it was like 4, then he was 10, then 16. I think he played 17 when he was his first game.
Wow.
And he scored a goal, I believe, his first. But they just never, they knew. But he was so small. Mm. So you're not, it's not like it's like some kid that's 6 foot at 13.
Right. It's not like spotting Shaq on the playground.
Yeah. They said they went out there and they knew it was him because they go, he'll be the smallest kid out there. And it was obvious who was the smallest kid out there. But then when they watched him, they were like, well, he's too small. And then they saw him touch the ball. And the guy said he walked around the pitch, I guess the field. And he goes, however long it takes to get around. He goes, usually it takes like a minute or 2 minutes to walk around. And he said he took him 15 because he just was staring at him, the kid watching him the whole time. And when he got to the end, he goes, go ahead and sign him and not tell him that I told you to do it. And they were like saying, like, all right, you're going to be on the team. And the dad's like, well, I mean, we don't have any, there's no paperwork or something. I could be wrong on all this, but I think that's what it was. And then they just wrote it on a napkin. Napkin started that. Greatest football. It's crazy. Greatest football player of all time.
Wow.
Yeah.
I had no idea.
Yeah. It's like, I mean, he has like, I believe kind of Gretzky stats.
Yeah.
Where it's stuff that's like, I don't know if it's going to get broken. And just, yeah, I mean, man, you just, what move, could there be a move that someone had done earlier that changes everything? I mean, he's worth $1 billion. I mean, it's the biggest sport on the world.
It's like a Scooter Braun finding Bieber that early, right?
Probably like, yeah.
Just recognizing this, this will be
maybe Taylor Swift.
Maybe I should have brought that up during the Discoveries episode.
Yeah. Yeah.
I wish I'd have known this.
Yeah. Maybe it's, yeah. It could be that. Did Usher find Bieber or Scooter Braun?
Scooter Braun linked him up with Usher, I think.
Yeah.
But you just recognize this guy's going to be a next level talent years from now.
Yeah.
Or pretty soon. But yeah, crazy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Harry Potter written on a napkin, too. Did you know that?
Oh, really?
Started on a napkin. A lot of stuff happens on napkins.
Yeah.
You should carry a notepad around with you.
It's a big napkin.
If you're a writer, she'd write the whole book. But yeah. She's
really small print.
Can I get a napkin? Yeah, yeah. How many? How many do you got?
I got a pack.
I got a novel. You just take all of them and the coasters and just walk over. She walks over to the table. Is it J.K. Rowling? Is that who wrote it? Yeah. She just writes over there and just writes all of it down.
She just kept going.
Puts her, licks the pen, like, rips through it.
I need more napkins.
Could I get
a whole paper towel roll?
Yeah. Just rid of, we got a paper towel. Perfect.
Hey, J.K., you want to type this up?
Nah, yeah.
I'm on a roll.
I'm on a roll right now. I don't want to be bothered. All right, this week we are talking, I'm sure you've looked at the title, oceans, right?
Yeah.
Oceans.
71% of the earth is covered by ocean.
Wow. Wow.
Are you mocking already out of the gate?
Yeah. Boys, no, I don't know.
It's going to be a long last hour here.
The oceans are, they're very big is the point.
Yeah. We are off to the races.
That's the theme of the show for sure. A third of the Pacific Ocean covers a third of the planet.
Yeah.
I'm just laying the groundwork here.
Yeah. Just so people know, it's water.
Yeah.
Oceans are water.
Big. Yep.
Not to be confused with a lake.
Or a sea or.
A sea. A sea is different than an ocean.
Yeah. Do we know what all the distinctions are between these different types of bodies of water? A gulf versus a.
I think I could eyeball it.
Yeah, it's almost like you know what it is when you see it on a map. But like, is there?
We'd always go to the Gulf of Mexico vacation. I was just, it looks like just a lake. Like it's just not the regular ocean. You know, it's like you feel like it's your Walmart version ocean.
Yeah,
you go and it's brown. You're like, oh god, that's our beach. We get to go to.
That's funny because I thought the exact opposite. When I'd go, I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm finally at the ocean. And then my friends are like, well, that's the Gulf of Mexico.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, you've never seen water before. You know, y'all had such a long journey down on the horse that you can't believe it.
From Lebanon,
Tennessee, there you go, whoa, back the horse up. Ryan jumps off.
There's five oceans. There was four when I was in school.
Yeah.
But they found another one.
Okay. Later. Pacific, Atlantic, Indian, Arctic.
Yep. It's that fifth one.
Persian Ocean.
That's a good guess. Now,
Peru. Does it start with a P?
No.
What's it start with?
An S.
Ooh, San Diego.
San Diego Ocean.
Salty.
Salty.
Yeah.
Salty Ocean. What is? Is it gonna be like? I can't believe you missed that one. Am I gonna get trashed for?
No, like I said in school.
I said San Diego, so I bet you're all right.
I meant both of us.
Yeah.
But if we had missed like Pacific, we would look silly. Right?
Yeah.
But I'm saying this is the hard one.
Pacific.
This one.
Atlantic.
Pacific Ocean.
Is it specific?
Yeah. It's a very specific ocean you have to think of.
Yeah.
This one came along in 2000. They declared it an ocean. So we weren't even.
Oh, how do you? Okay.
But this should have been your. You should have been in your wheelhouse.
This is when. Yeah.
I learned my oceans a little before 2000.
2000.
9 years old though. You should have been updated.
Y'all didn't talk about it then. No. Your teacher doesn't run in the room and go, guys.
Breaking news.
You will never believe there's a new ocean.
We were trying to get over all the Pluto stuff.
Yeah.
How do you have a new ocean in 2000? That's what the embarrassing with the aliens come down. And then we go, they're like, so what, how much is a body of land? You're like, oh, we just found one. And they go, you just, on your earth, you, Jimmy, y'all didn't recognize an ocean? A gigantic, most of this planet's water.
Yeah.
And you're telling me that y'all just discovered one part of, you go, oh, you know, there's an ocean over there.
Yeah.
I kept walking. Y'all have planes, right? And they go, yeah, we've been flying. Looking down. Everybody just looks at the land. We just never thought about it. Never thought about finding this ocean. How do you not find the ocean?
It's the Southern Ocean. It's goes around Antarctica. And before that, they just called that, oh, this part's Pacific, this part's Atlantic, Indian. But then they're like, nope, it's its own ocean.
How do they decide that?
The International Hydrographic Organization came up with this.
It's a made-up organization. We don't do much
of wildcats.
That's what we would tell the aliens. We're like, what's up, Antarctica? We just don't go up there. It's like your attic. You're like, there's stuff up there I don't know that's up there. That's the attic of the earth. Where you go, there's some people that know a lot about it, but Most of us, we're not going up there. Dude. Yeah. That's where we put all our stuff.
Yeah. It's just uncomfortable up there.
Yeah. It's always hot. It's too cold. Like an attic. There's no airflow. Just not a good.
Never got the insulation right.
I'm not going down there.
I'm not going up there. I'm more of a basement guy.
So did you name the Arctic?
Yeah.
The ocean. Arctic. So that's the attic, and the southern would be the basement as far as a globe.
Could be the way we think about it, but you could also, there's no up or down in space. So Antarctica could be, you could think of Antarctica
as the
top.
But it's the way we're standing. And so if it's below my feet, then.
Yeah. It's a lot easier to walk down south than it is.
But you understand what I'm saying.
I do. Yeah, okay. Scientists say
the way we're all standing.
Yeah.
Antarctica's up there.
No, Antarctica's down here.
Down?
Antarctica? Yeah, it's down
there. All right, well, what's the
Arctic Ocean's up there.
The Arctic Ocean's up there. Antarctica's down. So the Southern Ocean.
I think maybe.
Why would you, if you named an ocean in the year 2000, you come up with a Southern Ocean? The other ones are Atlantic, Pacific. They're like, you know. Yeah. And you got to think the last one's the dumbest name.
Southern.
You got, God, when they named that one, like 1740, 2000.
2000,
Year 2000.
Yeah.
We found it and then named it the Southern Ocean. Who named it? The International HOC.
Yeah. International Hydrographic Organization.
Oh, man.
Hydrographic. What is that?
What do you think those meetings are like?
Oh, God. They're not pretty boring. Found a new ocean. I mean, they had nothing really going on. 2000 was like a big year.
Yeah.
And they,
would that
and
happen?
Slowed back down.
I can't believe how busy it got for a while there. We thought we were all done.
The fax machine was just going off all day long. Just putting the, I put the lines around it.
Getting pages. So scientists say 20 million years ago, the Atlantic Ocean didn't exist. Because
it's pretty easy to say.
Yeah.
It's very easy to be a scientist. You just you just say stuff and
nobody can prove you wrong.
No one can prove you wrong. If you're smart enough to argue and talk about, you know.
They say South America and Africa were one big land, and then tectonic plates, they've separated.
So this is, we got Pangaea pulled up. This is where the Atlantic Ocean is right here. It's just kind of a.
Oh, it's a creek.
It's just basically, it's just a creek.
Just a creek.
It was the Atlantic Creek back then.
There's a guy that goes, I once jumped over the Atlantic Ocean. And they go, get out of here. And he goes,
It was more of a creek.
There's an old Tiger Woods, Arnold Palmer. I might have told that story where he goes, Arnold Palmer and Tiger Woods are playing golf. And Arnold Palmer goes, when I was your age, I could hit a ball over that tree. And Tiger's like, all right. And he tries it and hits the middle of the tree. And Arnold Palmer goes, when I was your age, that tree was only about 6 feet high. Very funny. And that's what that guy would say. He goes, I jumped over the Atlantic Ocean. Get out of here. And he goes, well, when I was your age, it was a crick.
So the Atlantic Ocean is getting bigger and the Pacific Ocean is getting smaller. The Atlantic Ocean grows every year by 2 inches.
Yeah.
And the Pacific shrinks every year by
an inch. Eventually, Pangaea, this will all join together again, but on the other end.
I guess.
And what's the Pangaea? Pacific Ocean will be a... Pangaea is the supercontinent before they all broke up.
Okay.
That's what this is called.
We were together.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the U.S. and Europe are...
You would drive to Brazil. You go Florida to Brazil is a pretty quick drive.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah,
you could go from DC to Morocco like that,
just like that.
Just take the bridge. You don't even need a bridge.
You just drive on down.
You're in Atlanta. You can see Algeria from
take
your house.
The 40, 65, 440. Well, now we're in Bolivia.
But Pennsylvania to Nashville, you're just there for life.
You're there for life. Can't do it. I got a show in Congo in 2 weeks, and I'll be back. I'm taking the bus. I feel like the states should have stayed together. It's been fun.
The continents?
The continents. All the continents should have stayed together. That's a shame.
Shame they didn't get along.
It's a shame that they broke up. It's funny that they broke up the way they broke up.
They wanted to go solo. They had differences.
Yeah.
94% of the living
Australia was just furious. Antarctica was, he was like, get out of here, dude. God, he goes, what are they saying? What is, I can't, what's Zimbabwe? What are the, what is he saying? And Antarctica's like, he's not saying anything. He doesn't care. Like, Antarctica, I feel like just very cold to everybody.
That's why he went the farthest.
He just
away.
Got in the way. Yeah. Antarctica just got in the way. And Australia was like, God, dude, I can't. It's like a guy sitting in front of you with a big hat. He's like, what is, I can't see.
I feel like Antarctica kind of just stayed there and everybody else left it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Australia went off on its own, wanted to do its own thing.
Yeah.
They brought along the New Guineas. There's Papua New Guinea.
There's Papua New Guinea. Came there. Down there.
Mama New Guinea.
Mama New Guinea. To the left of it. Yeah.
Huh.
Oh, man. This is crazy. Where's the Southern Ocean? I don't see it up here.
China.
The Chinese Sea.
China was way up there.
Wow.
Is the sea just a part of an ocean? That's what it feels like.
I mean, it's like the Sea of Galilee. That was its own thing.
Yeah.
But I think if you're lost at sea, that's usually going to be the ocean.
Okay.
So I think
you think you have to say that? You have to go, you're SOS. You go, it's lost at sea. This is an ocean, so we're good.
Can you be more specific?
Yeah.
Can you be more specific?
Yeah.
Your SOS?
Yeah. You're just hearing the, that doesn't make sense. It's China Sea. We're in Antarctica. That guy's out of his mind. It's delusional.
You're going the wrong way.
Hey, you're going the wrong way. Well, as you know where we're going.
94% of Earth's living species are in the ocean. So there's 240,000 accepted species that have been identified, but they're finding new species every day.
Every day?
Well, I mean, not every day. They don't make announcements about it. Is there announcements about
it? If it was every day, they just, like, we get it. You're finding stuff.
I mean, I think it's like a subspecies of some little.
It's just microscopic. Thing. A lot of them are probably single cell.
And there's a lot of loose, you know, oh, would you see that? What is that? It's a prey of frog.
But if
it's a new species.
It's a new species. And you name it. You get to name it.
Yeah.
And then everybody's like, all right.
The southern frog? That's what you came up with?
Southern frog.
But if 94% of species are in the ocean, and it says 5% of the Earth's oceans have been explored, only 5% have been explored, there could be a good argument. There's some crazy animals down there we've never found.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Probably at the bottom.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just some big thing. I mean, why would all those things could be around? You think in our lifetime we see some crazy animal? Like the giant squid. No one believed existed.
Yeah, until very recently.
So do we think there's like some, you know, they always have that shark that's like really big.
Mm-hmm. The Meg?
The Meg, like is that thing still floating around down there? Just sitting there?
Might be. We've only explored, what, 5%?
It's like a big school bus driving. 5%. Just...
Is the Meg, Meg's that movie we saw.
Yeah.
With Jason Statham.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a real thing. Maybe it could be.
Yeah, that movie was, the poster was really good. Great poster
for the Meg.
Yeah, unbelievable poster.
Better, it was the poster better than the movie.
Yeah,
yeah.
You're talking about the one. This
just
one,
just all of it.
Just it's any just of like, just like the artwork.
Yeah, it's just like the, you know, and that's not bad to show that big shark or that shark. Like that's a great white.
That's a cool one. That is.
But then
great
it
poster.
Was like it just the shark didn't feel that big.
Hey,
in the movie.
Yeah.
It's like when you see it, you're like,
disappointed. Okay.
Like, I mean, that looks enormous.
Yeah.
And then when you saw the movie, you're like, it's not as big as it made out to be.
Yeah.
The deepest part of the ocean is deeper than, if you put Mount Everest in the deepest part of the ocean, it would all be underwater. It's deeper than what Mount Everest is tall.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Mount Everest is 29,000 feet. The Mariana Trench is 36,000 feet deep.
And that's the deepest, as far as it goes.
As far as we found.
It's the bottom of Earth.
Only like three people have ever even been there. James Cameron's one of them.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's insane.
Yeah.
He went down there and filmed stuff. And there's life down there. There's animals.
Yeah.
They don't have, a lot of them don't even have eyes because it's darker than a cave down there. So they never developed them. But there's still animals living down there.
Just walking down there.
I don't know if they walk, but there's some.
There's bumping into a lot of like, sorry. It's the most I'm sorry has ever been said is down at the bottom. Sorry about that. Come through. On your left, some guy would just, if you just taught one of them how to use a flashlight, he'd dominate down there. Just one animal. Just throw him a bone. Can you imagine being all the way down there?
No, 7 miles deep. The water pressure is like incredible. And it's so these animals develop like really weird vertebrae.
Yeah. You imagine popping your ears down there? How good that must feel?
Just like
that first one.
Just yawning.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man.
And they live mostly off dead animals way up above that just float down there.
Oh, they just wait for it to fall down?
Yeah.
I mean, how long does it take? A couple of days?
Yeah, if it's a few miles down.
I mean, probably, you know, just slowly. When are you going to eat? I can see it.
Yeah.
See your dinner.
We'll see what wanders down.
Yeah. See what wanders heads on down to the bottom. You think they know they're at the bottom of the ocean? Where do you live
you
at?
You think they try to keep going down?
Yeah.
And they're like, I guess I'll just set up shop right
yeah.
here.
Yeah. And the tallest mountain in the world is not Mount Everest. It's Mauna Kea in Hawaii. It's 33,000 feet.
Okay, I don't know if you know what the ocean means, but it's...
What's it called?
Mauna Kea, Mauna Kea.
Yeah, Mauna Kea. Okay, so just most of it's underwater, so yeah. We don't care about it.
Oh, this mountain is underwater?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I didn't pick that up.
Yeah.
So the Mount Everest is the most land ocean.
Most land mountain, tallest mountain.
You think that's what Mount Everest, the other one says? Because I'm bigger than you, yeah? Where are you exactly? Call me when you lose some weight. Call when you lose some water weight. I'll be up here. Have you ever seen clouds? No? You're not high enough. Get out of here. Beat it. Can you believe this guy? McKinley comes over and goes, what was that guy's deal? And goes,
McKinley.
McKinley. His head's over. Fort Hood, what he was up to. Look at this dumb mountain and
Fort Hood. It's a military base.
Yeah. Well, Mount Fort Hood is Mount Hood. What is the other one? Mount Hood, right?
Are you like Mount Rainier?
No, I know Mount Rainier is my joke.
Yeah.
And I couldn't forget it. There's a Hood.
There is maybe a Mount Hood.
West Point
comes
Mount Hood. Over.
West Point comes over here. There it goes.
Get out of here, Fort Campbell.
Like a cavalry heads on in.
Five of the six largest waves ever surfed are in the same village in Portugal.
If you don't ruin my, I know the village, but don't ruin my, you're going to give away my show. I'm watching 100-foot wave.
Okay.
So, Navarre is where it takes place. George McNamara, but I'm on like episode 4.
Okay.
So the biggest wave, there's 80 feet, 78 feet, 80 feet, and there's bigger than that. And then, yeah. So, I mean, I wonder if I just got to give it up. Did I got to give up my...
No. I'm not saying that. So you know about this then.
Yeah, that's the 100-foot wave I've been watching.
Yeah. And the reason, I mean, you know this probably better than I do, is because there's a Great Canyon underneath it, right?
Right where it comes up. So that's why the waves are very unpredictable and they can get very big.
And the canyon's like deeper than the Grand Canyon or something?
Yeah. I thought it might have been close to the shore? Yeah, real close
to the
shore.
It's like 6,000 feet deep or something, and 16,000 feet deep, and the Grand Canyon is like 6,000 feet deep, which causes these huge waves, so all the world's best surfers go there.
It was not an area that no one knew. So that George, I think it's George McNamara.
Yeah.
And then, is his name George?
I think so. Garrett.
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 Garrett McNamara. Sorry, yeah. Garrett, this guy's 45, 50 years old. And he finds out, he's always looked for the biggest wave. And he went to Portugal to do it. And then he actually changed Portugal. He's like a I mean, they love him there. He's like the king of Navarre.
I don't know.
And because he brought all these people there, like all these big surfers now go there. No one knew about it. And they were, and some guy sent him a message or something. Was like, hey, because he would always get messages like, hey, there's a big wave in this country. And he's been all over the world. He's like, they'd always go to Hawaii.
Yeah.
And then so he was like, all right, finally, the guy's like, tells him, and they kind of email back and forth like 5 years, and finally he goes and he sees it, ends up like just like kind of living there for a while. And he had the world record 78 feet. It's an 8-story building.
Wow,
it's crazy.
Well, yeah, this is a good picture of it. I think this is the same.
This is the one. So yeah, when you watch it, it's just unbelievable, dude. It's so big, and it's hard to even realize it. And then another guy came and he got it 80 feet. And then so...
Do people die trying this?
I don't know if they have... I'm trying to think of someone... They get injured very badly. He got injured very badly. People do die.
Yeah.
A lot of surfers do die. I mean, you just get hit. They say you just get hit. You're just... It's just pure chaos. Like, there you go. So the guy did die.
Yeah.
When was that? He died recently.
Yeah. January.
Oh, wow.
A couple near deaths on January.
Yeah. I mean, they just get hit, and like it just doesn't stop. Like you just like pounded, and then you know, it's crazy.
So it's a good mini series. What you're saying?
Yeah, it's interesting. I just didn't know anything about surfing. I think surfing seems interesting, and like so waves.
Have either of y'all tried to do it before?
No,
no.
I think I'm done. I don't think I'm past like trying. Like I tried skiing and skiing's not, I don't have it. I think you got to try it very early. And if you do it early, like you just got it.
You don't think you can pick it up later?
I mean, I don't.
What do you think my chances are of surfing this wave?
Of surfing?
This wave.
Oh, this wave. You're half the size of it. So that helps. And it's.
Have you ever surfed?
Nah, boogie board. We were big boogie boarders back in the day.
I don't even know. What's the difference?
Yeah, you don't stand up on it. You just kind of sit it under your belly and just.
Just boogie?
You just boogie on out, man.
It's the poor man surfing.
Body
it's
boogie surf
board
too?
Yeah, that's like the boogie board is you could do it. You
Panama
lay on
City.
A board. Yeah. It's very fun. I mean, people are very good at boogie boarding. But yeah, you couldn't. You would just fall. I mean, you would fall 8 stories. You fall 8 stories. That's if you fall at the top of this thing, you just fall 8 stories to the ground.
Yeah.
And that water fills. And the water doesn't stop. That's what's so crazy is the ocean just doesn't. There's never a break. It's just, yeah.
Yeah, you don't factor in at all. The ocean, I think they just don't care about you. It just does what it wants.
It does what it wants. And that, and especially so there, so there it has that, that underneath it, like the cavern, like the canyon.
You can fall into that?
No, but I went scuba diving once. Yeah. And this one girl, I've only done it once, and but I remember this one lady on the boat. She could go scuba diving if she could see the bottom of the ocean, but if you went to a part where you couldn't see the bottom, she couldn't do it because mentally it was like you're technically 1,000. You could be 1,000 feet in the air,
yeah.
If you really think of it like that. Yeah. And so like she could see the bottom, she could do it, but there'd be parts, and it was kind of like weird. Like it'd be like it just goes down, and you would just swim over it and just watch it go down, and you think. For some reason, I could sink. I would just, I would never stop. I couldn't even see the bottom. I went 100 feet.
That's so scary.
I got to 100 feet.
You went 100 feet down?
Yeah. We were close to 100, and I was like, let me go. And I went, you get like a watch or something that tells you how far.
Altitude.
Yeah. And I went and touched 100 just to get back up.
Where were you?
There's a big pool. And
the Y?
The Y, yeah. Donaldson YMCA, I believe. I think that's where I did get my lot. Like you have to go get trained
in a pool. You did, yeah.
I was in Mexico. Is when I graduated high school. Jeff Moffitt, and we went with his dad. I came back with braided hair. All my hair was braided,
like Michael Scott.
Like yeah, exactly. But I did my whole head. Yeah.
Do you have pictures of that?
I do somewhere. I could find it somewhere.
Yeah, I'd like to see that.
Yeah.
Do you have blonde tips to them too?
No, I did that once.
You're going all out.
I did that once, yeah. The blonde tips. And the problem is I don't like fixing my hair that much. I fix it like only time I really fix it is like on stage or if maybe you're going somewhere. Yeah. So when you have blonde tips, if you don't fix your hair, when it lays down, it just looks like a leopard. Like it looks good when it's all styled, but you have to style it every day. So I don't want to style it.
That's a commitment.
It's a, yeah. So I don't really ever put stuff in my hair unless I'm doing something. So it just didn't work out. And then you're like, all right, well, I've already committed to it. So I got to just mm-hmm. ride this out. Mm-hmm. And then you just wait. And then finally you're back to normal.
How long did that take?
I don't remember. I mean, it was, you just wore a hat a lot and you take it off and you just look like a leopard on your head.
Do you ever have any crazy haircuts, Brian?
Hair.
Did you get experimental?
Jimmy, you ever have your hair, Brian?
Yeah. I mean, you had a 2-month window that you could were old enough and had the hair to do it. They go
from May of 86 to.
I mean, people that go bald early. I mean, you're not fully bald. Travis, my tour manager, been bald since. I mean, he had a ton of hair in high school, and then he went bald pretty quick. But I mean, yeah, you don't even have time. Some people, like, it's kind of crazy. They don't, you're like, you got to, if you want to do it, you better do it now.
Yeah.
Because you don't, and before you can even think, oh, I want to do it, you're like, well, it's already over.
You don't have time to make a plan.
You don't have time. You're like, but now I'm in a phase that I would like to put some blonde stuff in my hair. And you're like, too bad.
Too late.
Too late.
Mine was a gradual decline.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
But no, I never.
You never got crazy with it.
No, I never had a mullet.
Yeah.
Did yours, will you lose it all, you think? Or will it stay kind of like that? Have you started keeps?
No.
Would you do keeps?
Isn't it keeps for people who haven't lost their hair yet?
Yeah, but I mean, it's you keep what you have. So, like, you don't want to go down more, right?
I don't know. Should I keep be going?
Bald?
Should I keep going, or should I try to get some back? Mm. Or a toupee? Should I try a toupee?
You have a lot of hair in the back.
Yeah, just a frontal?
Just a front.
You do the full cue ball. I think just go for it, man.
Just to be bald?
Just do it, dude.
He'd look like something. It already doesn't. And he would just be like, oh, man. Everybody be telling him how brave he is. Just all day long would just be.
Everybody be giving me a baseball?
Yeah.
Here, you keep
he'd walk out with a bunch, and there you go. Now let him keep it, son. Little kids coming up giving him a ball. It's opposite of the Andrew Jones ball. Hey, mister, I caught this ball with my bare hand, but my daddy said I should give it to you, and here you go.
I was hoping we talk about the ocean, my hairline.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry.
It's all right.
Both pretty obvious to see, so.
Everybody's noticed both of them.
Yeah. They both cover 70% of what they, the land that they're on.
All the water in the oceans on the world, they all flow into each other. It's one big global conveyor belt. Yeah. It takes 1,000 years for water to travel all the way around the world.
Hmm.
Another thing, how they know that, I don't know.
Yeah. And why? Where's the, they have a line that just like, could you go swim like right on a line?
Like a lazy river? It'll just take you around?
No, there's like water currents, but.
But I mean, is there a part where you're like, oh, I'm in the middle of the Atlantic and the Pacific or whatever, the ocean to touch?
There's probably not a sign out there, but.
Yeah.
So they.
But you know you can go stand on all four states in Utah. Yeah,
there's just like a buoy floating out there.
Yeah, they're like, right here is where they merge. And then you kind of see it. You go, I actually see it. Water looks a little different. You're like.
It's a little different color.
It's a little different. Texture's looks like your, a little different. My hair when I did the. You're like, yeah, I do see that.
Yeah, I do see the difference.
A little milkier.
And.
Doesn't come off as easy.
In 1992, a shipment of bath toys from China to the U.S. Fell off a cargo ship. 28,000 rubber ducks, or friendly floaties, as they were called, fell into the Pacific Ocean. And oceanographers started tracking them, and they ended up all over the world, including as far away as Europe. And some of these are still out there. Like, even all these years later, come up with.
So shore. Maybe this is why we don't have most of the ocean discovered, is we get our scientists get distracted when they go, oh, these duckies fell in the, I start following them around.
Yeah.
And we followed them around for, that took 10 years of our life. Like, I mean, that's how long this thing goes. That took 10 years.
But they liked it. They're like, we can test the water currents by see where these rubber ducks end up.
And how do you know which one's which?
Well, you don't know which one's which, but, well, oh, like, how do you know it's one that fell off that ship?
I'd imagine they're not all different.
So I think they were marked a certain way.
They signed their name, and then you got to go, like, playing that game that you find. Nope.
Oh, no. Like at the fair?
Like at the fair. Yeah. Just picking them up. You write China on it, and you're in Lake Michigan. Look at that.
That's pretty crazy. Pacific Ocean ends up in Scotland. One of them did.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that is crazy.
Well, but they're all connected, so I figured they would, right?
Like, yeah, but that's not easy to get there.
Just think about how long it would take.
How long did it take?
Well, it started in 92, and they're still finding them occasionally. Yeah. So
I would have guessed thousands of years to get out there. So it's moving quicker.
It's moving pretty
quicker
quick.
Than I'd like, yeah. To be honest with you.
Yeah, quicker than you think. Mm-hmm.
The ones that ended up in Europe, they think it went up north over the Arctic, like over Canada, through the Arctic, and came back down that way.
Oh. Didn't get stuck in the ice.
Yeah. Or someone just, they do all this, and they make a big announcement, and they go, now we've had that, another one of those duck ships broke. The ships were bad. And you go, oh. So yeah. He goes, oh yeah, those things go down all the time.
So one broke down in the Atlantic Ocean too. That's where all those came from.
Yeah. Yeah. And they all look the same.
Uh-huh. Think about messages in a bottle. What a last resort that is. Who does that?
I think that's really cool. I mean, not for help, but just to put something in there and throw out and see who gets it.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Is that why they were doing it?
Some people do. Just see who finds it.
Yeah, I think people do it now just to be like, maybe someone finds it one day.
I thought it was a guy on an island, like, he wrote help in a bottle and he's tossed it out in the ocean. It was like, dude, you know.
I think that's more movies.
Now they throw it and then you find it and you just look to the left and the guy's there and he goes, I just did that. And it gets over that or that quick to
push
him.
Push it back.
Yeah. Now he walks over and they go, I just found a message. But he goes, I just threw it out. I'm trying to get it past the current and it won't go out. So just throw it back.
Throw it.
They go, this thing looks like not even pretty new. Yeah, I wrote it 20 minutes ago. You weren't supposed to find it. You're supposed to find it in 100 years. I think you would throw it. Has a message bottle ever worked?
Yeah.
And it's worked.
Yeah, I mean, there's cases where people have found like years later. And
because of the message bottle.
I think there was one recently in Tennessee where someone found one like downstream or something.
And helped someone?
No, not distress. I'm talking about like purposely you put a message.
Yeah, I'm talking about like, has it ever helped in like
rescue someone?
I mean, if you're like on an island, why would you not? I mean, maybe you could use that bottle, I guess.
Yeah, how'd you even get I guess if the bottle was with you.
Well, that's what helps.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like all the stories are like, you find it 100 years later. No, isn't this neat? But I was thinking, you know, I'm stranded on this island. My longitude and latitude is this. Come help me.
Yeah.
That's what I thought people were doing.
Yeah, that's probably not going to work.
Well, you try.
Yeah.
At least try.
At a certain point, I'll just try anything, man.
Yeah. If you're out there
you might need that bottle to catch rainwater.
No, I know. That's the only thing. But, like, if you'd want to give up the bottle, but maybe you have two bottles.
Maybe develop a water system first before you throw out the message in a bottle.
So the most, the longest someone's been stranded at sea and was found, survived. There's a couple of cases. There's a guy from El Salvador who left on a fishing trip in November 2012 and was found January 2014. He was gone. He was out 438 days.
It's like Manifest, the Netflix.
I was
Manifesto? What is it?
Manifest.
Manifest.
Yeah, I was thinking Castaway, but.
I like Castaway.
But he ended up getting sued by the family of his shipmate because he ate his buddy that was with him. So his family sued him for $1 million for cannibalism.
But his buddy died. So they were on the fishing boat?
They were on a fishing boat, and they got lost at sea. A storm came, and they survived several months by catching fish and birds and drinking turtle blood and rainwater.
Yeah.
But then one of the birds had a poisonous snake in it, and it killed his buddy. The buddy died from it. So his friend asked him, don't eat my corpse. So he kept him. He said he kept him on the boat for 6 days talking to his corpse. But he finally he's like, I'm going crazy. So he threw his corpse over. And months later, he was rescued on some
Wait, so he island. Didn't eat it?
The family of the guy who died sued him, said that he ate him. But he says he didn't.
Yeah.
So there's a lawsuit, $1 million lawsuit.
Still going on? How could you even sue him?
Well, he was the one who hired this guy who went out to sea.
So he thought this was a long game? And then he's a cannibalist. And he's like, well, I got to make it look good.
So I'm going to be stranded
at sea for, I fed a bird a poisonous snake. I don't want it to come back to me.
Yeah.
So I fed a bird a poisonous snake. Just hoped. That was my sign if this was going to work out or not.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I see that bird kind of limping over. It's flying to me. And I go, uh-oh.
Yeah, it's time.
And he goes, you swear you're not going to eat me when I die? Don't eat, because I swear to
you. Pinky promise, dude.
Why would I do that? You think that's what I did? I did said all this
yeah,
stuff?
Yeah, I did all this just
like I did all of this just so I could eat. Why would I not just eat you like when you're, you know, not have a poisonous snake inside of you? And it goes, good point.
But they left.
Played cards for one day when he dies. Took all his money and then he,
pick a card.
Yeah.
Man.
And then he goes, I didn't eat. Why don't they just go? They got to eat him. They go, we think you did. How do you prove that?
Yeah, I don't know, but I think they just wanted. He wrote a book about his days at sea, and the family of the other victim, I think, wanted some of the money. And his lawyers said the book didn't sell very well.
Yeah,
said it only sold 1,500 copies in the U.S.
Oh.
How bad is that book?
Because it's an amazing story.
How bad of a writer are you that you can't write a book about that work?
Well, let's get someone to help you write it. No, I got it. There's a lot of stuff I got to work out. You can't see.
I got to get my thoughts together.
I got to get my,
my alibi.
This says after 11 days in a hospital after he was saved, he was diagnosed with a fear of water.
Yeah, I bet so.
That'd be a tough one to have, stranded at sea. Fear of water. I'm terrified of water, by the way.
Just in general?
I don't like the ocean. I don't like swimming in it.
It's crazy to be like they're accusing him of cannibalizing their relative in order to survive, despite their pact that they said they would not be eaten after death. Which is just very funny. They go, we think you did it. You go, well, I find that hard to believe because we both agreed that I wouldn't. So tell me where that argument is just doesn't even make sense. You're like you're, it's a perfect.
Yeah.
Like if you're like, if I killed someone, you're like, did you kill this person? You're like, I don't know. It's pretty hard when I've never killed someone in my life. And you go, well, that's a good comment. That's a good point.
When we agreed not to kill each other.
I agreed. I promised him I would never. That's what I'm like. If a wife or husband ever kill one another, the other one should go, well, that seems ridiculous because we promised we would never kill each other. Yeah. And they go, well, that's a good point.
Yeah.
All right. Well, find someone else is out there, you know?
There was another case, the Tonga boys. These were teenage boys in the 1960s who stole a fishing boat just for fun, and they got shipwrecked on a remote island, and they were there for 15 months. And it's an interesting case study because there's The Lord of the Flies, which was about kind of like that, where they all turned on each other and killed each other. Mm-hmm. These guys cooperated. They quickly came up with a system,
formed a band,
leadership.
Like. Yeah.
They started a fire and kept it going for like a month, and they all just quickly worked together, and the older boys kind of helped the younger boys. So it's a great story as far as cooperation and working together, and they were eventually rescued, and I think some of them are still alive today.
Oh, yeah.
But they say it's a good example of how humans don't just all turn on each other. But
did they have a camera?
I think that's when they went back to, which why would they ever want to go back to that place? But
yeah, See the old neighborhood.
Oh, I'd be afraid it'd be like Gilligan's Island.
Do you remember that? Right over there. You vomited. We thought you were gonna die. Right here's where we talked about if we're gonna eat you or not. Right there? Yeah. Yeah, we talked about it. Had decent though. You were weak. But we decided not to.
So let's say the three of us are on a plane somewhere, it crashes, the three of us are stranded on an island.
What's the system?
What's the approach? I mean, do we just defer? Is Nate the leader, or do we? Is there seniority, or what's my role? How can I help out the three of us?
I feel like we've had this question before.
Yeah, we talked about
what we'd do if we were a heist.
Yeah, this is different.
This is
strange. Now we talked about like
cannibals.
That's strange.
That's strange in the mountains or something like that. Uh-huh. Hiking. So this is like Speed 2 was on last night, and so I watched some of that, and it's just so funny that they just did it, and they go, "What about a boat?"
Yeah,
and they go, "All right, yeah." They go, "Can't stop the boat. Boat's gonna hit something." Great. Yeah. That's unbelievable.
So same, but a little different.
Yeah. I mean, and you're just like, that's fine. And they got Sandra Bullock.
Yep. But Jason Patrick, right?
Yeah.
Is he playing the same character?
Yeah, I think so. I didn't watch the whole thing. But it was, it's like Keanu Reeves, like, I was surprised Sandra Bullock, but I guess maybe she was just kind of popping off.
Yeah.
So maybe they could have got it. Keanu Reeves was like, about to blow up and be huge, so he was like able to get out of it. But it's just, I mean, the odds of Speed 2 just being like, yeah, what if we do it on a boat? And they go, that's pretty different. All right, I'll listen.
I love that every movie you've mentioned since your big diatribe is a sequel to something, just another one of the Medeas or Speed 2.
Well, the Medeas are all pretty different.
Is there a Speed 3?
Flight Risk. No, I think it's a joke. That'd be great. he talks Speed 3. Is there a Speed 3?
Will there be a Speed 3?
Keanu Reeves reportedly returning for Speed 3.
Uh-oh.
This was a year ago, though.
Yeah.
Haven't heard anything since.
December 5th.
They could do another Speed and just like... But that's like this thing that I've talked about. They just make another one, I guess. I'm actually, what if I go make this now after all my, I yell about Marvel. And then, yeah. You know what? I'm going to re-release my Tennessee Kid special. I'm going to just go do it again.
Tennessee adult.
Yeah. Just do all the jokes again.
Nate's, can you swim good?
I'm a great swimmer.
I know you can. Can you swim?
Are you actually a good swimmer?
He can swim.
In what
dive.
Way?
Just every freestyle. Like, you let me choose. Don't worry about what's going on over here.
You swim like endurance.
I'm fast.
Okay, speed.
Speed.
Okay.
I could swim endurance. Mm-hmm. I'm a machine. I can keep going, dude.
Man.
I'll talk about it. I go.
You think more than
Laura calls me a machine. She tells me that I have to go and I have to go. When I do stuff with someone, she'll say, you need to remember that maybe this person can't go as much as you can.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to, like, I go walk around and I go somewhere. It's like, I can just go.
Yeah.
And like, so like this golf course when we went is like, I can walk around for 12 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have to like.
And that carries over into the water.
Carries over in the water. So then I have to, if I'm with someone that doesn't, I have to, Laura goes, you need to make sure that you need to be like, hey, if you need to rest or something, like go. If I go mm-hmm. walk around my dad, it's like, or anybody, like. I got to be like, hey, oh yeah, are you too hot? Like I go golfing in 100 degree weather.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a machine. Like Bert Kreischer.
I couldn't do what Tom Hanks did in Castaway. I mean, he was very smart, came up with the currents, and remember he created a makeshift raft?
I think when you have, that's all you have to do, you could figure some stuff out. You'd probably be up there watching TV.
I mean, maybe I could eventually learn how
some sticks, you tie some sticks in a square together and watch these birds fly through it. And we go, dude, how long is this? And you go, it's almost over. And we go, all right.
Same thing on every channel.
Same idea. Do they have the weather? It's like, it's coming up. I think it's cloudy today.
The most remote area on Earth is a spot in the...
I think I would forget you were on the island pretty quick.
If the three of us were...
Three of us there together. You'd show... I'd be like, God, dude, where have you been?
I'd be Wilson.
Yeah. What else happened?
You try to save me if I was out to sea, but...
I think Aaron would hit you in the head with a rock quick. And I'm like, what are you doing? You're like, dude, who are we kidding ourselves? You think he's going to survive this? I'm like, well, let him get weak first.
Let him die naturally. Yeah. What happened next week?
Yeah.
You just got charged with murder for no reason.
Yeah. And then they hear, boat pulls up. And he goes,
right after
and
that.
You just murdered him, dude. Like, are you kidding me? Oh, God.
They both have to bury me real fast.
Yeah.
It was just two of us.
Just two of us.
The remote, would you kill me right away?
No. I mean, can you swim?
Barely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just take him out swimming. He'd take you out swimming.
Yeah. Hey, can you grab me that?
Hey, Brian, let's go for a swim.
Yeah.
The most remote place on Earth is a place in the Pacific Ocean, Point Nemo, 1,670 miles from land. The closest, if you were out there at that spot, the closest you'd be to other humans are the astronauts on the International Space Station.
Wow. Wow. That's out there.
What's it called?
Point Nemo.
Point Nemo.
It's not an actual island. It's just a location in the ocean that it's the furthest distance from land.
Yeah, it's just right here.
Just in the middle. Jeez. South Pacific Ocean.
Almost in the Southern Ocean.
But you'd be right next to those people over there.
What people?
Well, that's 1,600 miles.
Up above it?
Right? Yeah. Oh, we're doing your right.
Oh, that's Chile?
And then New Zealand's right there.
Yeah, but I think that's pretty far, dude.
Yeah.
That's not like, you can't see it from there.
It's farther than space.
1,600 miles,
day
supposedly.
Day swim.
Yeah, you're a machine.
I'm
my
a machine, dude.
The Pacific Ocean, I mean, sorry, the Bermuda Triangle.
Oh, boy.
I like the Bermuda Triangle.
Yeah.
I think it's fun.
Unexplained disappearances, ships, planes.
Bermuda Triangle was very big, I think, in my young days.
You don't hear about it as much, do you?
You don't hear about it as much. You kids now don't care about.
Christopher Columbus referenced it when he sailed through there.
See? He made it through.
Hmm. Yeah.
He also thought manatees were mermaids.
So. Well, maybe they were.
So what goes on at the Bermuda Triangle? It's just...
just weird stuff. Boats disappear. Planes have disappeared.
Yeah.
They think maybe it's some weird gravitational pull of the Earth.
Okay. So it's not something supernatural. It's a...
Could well, be. They don't know.
Some people think aliens, Middle Earth, things get sucked in.
And they can't go investigate it because when you go in there...
no one comes out.
Yep.
Wow.
When I say people, I'm not saying scientists.
Do planes fly over the Bermuda Triangle?
I think they do.
Okay. A lot of Bigfoot people have been in there.
Yeah.
That's what they take their boats and they go talk about Bigfoot. Do planes fly? Do they fly over it now? Or they avoid it? Is it like the 13th floor at a hotel?
No, I think they fly over it.
You just go, we got some weather coming up.
I think they figured it out.
Yeah. Why do they avoid it?
So I don't think they avoid it.
But why do they really not know what ever happened?
I think it's just coincidence and kind of superstition. I don't think it's
50
really...
and 20, 50 ships and 20 planes just disappear.
Yeah.
And we're just kind of breezing over it.
Well, I mean, yeah, like
50 ships and 20 aircraft have gone missing.
That Malaysian flight. That wasn't Bermuda Triangle, but it, I mean, I had no idea where it is. Well, Indian Ocean, I guess.
Yeah, all right.
UFOs, I mean, that's a big theory now is that UFOs...
are in the ocean.
Yes.
Yeah.
And one of those recent videos that was released, you see it go down, they yell splash, and it goes in the ocean.
Yeah.
And hey, who yelled splash?
I think the people in the Navy ship.
Okay.
Watching it.
I thought you meant...
the aliens?
The UFO went down. They yelled, splash.
They cannonball.
Cannonball. Yeah. Jackknife.
Splash.
Yeah. You ever do the jackknife?
Oh, just, yeah.
Is that that's you hold your leg back?
One oh, knee up and then slam into it. Yeah, that's a big splash.
That's a big over the cannonball.
Mm-hmm. Oh, bigger for sure.
Really?
I think so. When I did it, at least.
I feel like you'd be a cannonball guy.
Yeah.
I was a flip, dude.
You did flips?
Oh, I was doing all kinds of flips, man.
Really?
Yeah. I thought you hated the water.
Oh, a pool's different.
Yeah.
You know, you can see what's going on at a pool.
Yeah.
So that could have been your freestyle at the Olympics. Just do a flip.
Just a flip.
Just to go, just fall forward and let the rest do the rest.
I stand at the edge of the pool and just lean forward.
Just lean forward.
Fall
and
in.
It's just perfectly, you land just straight on your feet. Would you do a flip on a high dive?
Oh, I know. No, I wouldn't do that.
Have you ever gone on a high dive?
No.
No.
Dude, no. I'm scared of heights.
Yeah.
The diving board I'm talking about is like, I don't know,
three
feet off the ground. Yeah.
Would you flip and dive or just flip and feet?
No, just flip and
Do back flip?
It's, you know, wherever it hits the water, you just kind of deal with it. Yeah. You don't really have a plan. You're just, I'm going to go around until I'm done.
Yeah. You know? I flipped once and went straight up and landed on my back on the diving board.
Ooh.
I was like probably like six or something. Yeah. And I go straight up and just landed. I remember it. Just land straight.
And like you landed on it?
I didn't go forward.
You didn't fall into the water after that? You like landed back on
the board? No, I landed. I mean, I just jumped straight up. And then did the flip and landed on my back on the diving board. Just I think I had floaties on. Like I was that little. Yeah.
You remember in Shallow Hal when she jumps off the diving board and that kid is up in a tree?
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, there's a place off the coast of Malibu called Sycamore Knoll that they think maybe is a secret alien base or government secret base there that they go underwater there because you can see on satellite images that. There's something down there that's circular that they think could be an alien ship or who knows what.
And no one goes over there and checks it out?
I guess it's not maybe allowed by just the average person.
So there's your answer?
Yeah.
Where is it at?
Off the Malibu coast.
It looks like one of those things in the middle of a pizza.
You
know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Like the little table?
But the UFO community, they think maybe the oceans were. Even that Captain Favor, the Navy pilot who saw the Tic Tac, he said it was circling above the water in the ocean.
Oh, I thought you were describing a TikTok and you called it a TikTok.
Yeah, my God.
Brian, that's the oldest thing you've ever
heard. Yeah,
that's fair.
He saw it on Tic Tac.
Tic Tac, something like that. Space face.
Well, the Tic Tac, okay, the UFO.
The Tic Tac UFO.
Shaped like a Tic Tac,
It was, they saw water swirling and they think maybe it came up from the ocean. But I mean, if they're going to hide here, it seemed like it's a good place to hide.
We've only explored 5% of it.
What if Bigfoot's down there?
Might be.
Swimming, doing the breaststroke.
They think there's oceans, like Saturn and Jupiter have moons that have oceans.
Yeah.
And they think that's probably the best place for life to be found in our solar system. Outside of Earth, of course. Saturn and Jupiter have moons.
And the moons have oceans?
Yeah.
Europa is the one, right?
Europa and Euclides or Enceladus, I don't know. But anyway, they're covered by ice. So they're like really thick ice. But underneath the ice, they say, is oceans. And they think there could be some type of, we're probably talking microscopic, like basic life.
How do we know? How do we know if there's an ocean underneath there?
I don't know.
They don't, because no one asks, man. I mean, it's, what does it matter? Does it, you don't really know. It's weird that your moon has an ocean. It just spills all the time. It falls off. I just like, if you go there, and they go, what's wrong with your moon, dude? Like, that's what you say to. You go to your buddy's house, he lives on Saturn.
Mm-hmm.
What's up with your moon, dude? It's weird at night.
Yeah.
And he goes, I don't know. He goes,
it's got a subsurface ocean.
It's got an ocean up there. Yeah, like gets like rains a little bit, right? You go, I don't know. It's weird.
The volcanic sea.
It always tastes like, so you take a shower in Florida and it's always like salty. You know, like it's that's how you know, everywhere you go in Florida, you take a shower.
I've never noticed that.
You haven't?
No.
I've always noticed, like, the water just is different, like, when you're near the ocean. It's really like regular showers or just
even like tap water. Like,
it, yeah, it just, when you take a shower, it just feels a little, it doesn't feel like, you know.
Interesting. I never noticed.
Maybe they're just getting it out of the ocean.
Maybe.
Straight from the ocean.
Yeah, and they don't tell you. By the time it gets there, it's enough that you just don't pay attention. You're...
There's a Great Pacific Garbage Patch. It's a place out in the Pacific Ocean, 600,000 square miles, where garbage just, because of the currents, just kind of swirls.
Uh-huh.
It's twice the size of Texas.
Wow.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Still not as big as Alaska.
Yeah.
173 Rhode Islands.
Did you do the math?
I did the math.
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah. 173
Rhode Island. Dude, that's so big.
It's just plastic and garbage. And it's
that,
just
think about it. Twice the size of Texas.
Yeah.
And we don't even know where this is at. Like, it's, that's how much ocean there is.
I almost don't believe this.
No, there's video of it.
There's, yeah, a guy lives on it.
I think there's
a
somebody.
Guy lives on it?
There's a man that lives, he walks on it.
He has to,
it's
clean
like
it
walking
up.
Like when in Star Wars.
Yeah.
When, you have to walk through all that trash.
Mm-hmm. In that compact?
Yeah, in that compact.
Yeah, look at it.
So it's like, it's that bad? Three times, twice the size of Texas?
I don't know if it's all that thick, but the whole area is.
Why don't they go? What if you went, you go there, look for your wedding ring? What if?
There's a message in a bottle out there.
Yeah, oh, there's a lot of stuff out there. Why don't they just, could they go get it?
I think I saw in 60 Minutes or something, there's some guy who's come up the way with like a big net that he thinks can just call it in. And like try to clean it up.
And then go put it another ocean.
Indian Ocean.
Yeah, go to the Indian Ocean.
Dump it on them.
Get some on the Southern, dude. They're new. They need to pick up the Southern, slack a little bit.
Yeah.
There's nobody down there.
I know. So apparently it's just, it's about garbage concentration per square kilometer. So a lot of this, what we consider the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, is like 1 pound of trash per square kilometer.
Yeah.
Everyone's not impressed.
You're not impressed with it.
You just throw your stuff anywhere. No, I'm not saying it's not a problem.
Have you seen this car?
Yeah.
It doesn't surprise me.
Yeah. So you're a litter. You're, you're for littering? What do you do after when you do a drive-thru? Do you throw it in a lake, McDonald's bag? Do you find the nearest water? Is that how you throw away all your trash? What do you do like when you walk your trash down from your apartment and you got to go down, you drive it to Percy Priest Lake and then just go right when you drive over the dam, you just launch a...
There's a community garden up the street. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just sprinkle it out.
Yeah.
There's also a dead zone where, because the water's heating in the oceans, there's a place near Oregon, 7,700 square miles. Nothing can live there because the oxygen levels are plummeting. So sea creatures are dying because, they say because of rising.
So if you went underwater there, you couldn't breathe.
Well, I don't know. You couldn't breathe, period, unless you had a tank, but, so I think that would still work.
Yeah.
All right.
That's way bigger than I thought it was. That's a pretty big dead zone.
You're giving that a lot more credit than you did. It's not three Texases.
It's bigger than Rhode Island.
Yeah, I mean, if you smushed it together, I don't think it would be.
Yeah, but if you looked at this and it was like, well, this just means that 1 pound is dead for every square kilometer.
Everybody that's dead in there. Well, why don't the fish get out of there?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Move it along, fellas.
Because they forget.
Yeah.
Forget they're in a dead zone.
A goldfish always forgets until he never knows. So the fish goes, hey, I can't breathe. We should get out of here. And then they stay. And then they go, hey, I can't breathe. And it's just
constant.
Constant.
Yeah.
There's a fish in Canada trying to go visit his family in California. He's like, I can't come for Christmas this year. There's a dead zone.
It's getting bigger.
Yeah, I would have to go all the way around it. You know how bad that
just
is.
It's a thing.
Yeah. You know, the Bermuda Triangle reaches out.
There's a billionaire in the United Arab Emirates. I hope I'm saying that right.
Who's, you're not.
How do you say it?
United Arab Emirates.
Am I right?
Emirates. Is that right? Am I right?
United Arab Emirates. Am I right? Am I right?
Yeah. About the Emirates.
Am I right?
UAE.
Okay, UAE. Yeah.
UAE.
And he's,
Emirates. Am I right?
Animal rights.
Animal rights. Activists?
And they don't have much rain in UAE. So he's come up with a plan to haul an iceberg from Antarctica.
Is this the same net guy?
No, I think this is a different guy. But he's
they should meet because they both got some wild ideas.
What if they run into each other on the ocean? Move it along. But he wants to haul it from Antarctica. 20 billion gallons of water, he said. They could be drinking water for a million people for 5 years if he can get this iceberg.
It's not a bad idea.
It's not that long.
I mean, it'd be worth the trip. You wouldn't regret it when you got back.
I think you got to come up with a better solution than fight like you're. How long is it going to take to get that?
I don't know. How do you just lasso it?
How much do you lose as you go across, as the iceberg then goes to Florida and it's like, it's like 79 degrees now. And you're like, well, now we're losing.
Tommy gets home. Yeah. It's this big.
Yeah.
I did it, guys.
Yes. Where is it? It's just a cup. He's got this cup and he just goes, he goes, I didn't take it through. And then he drinks it.
Just to finish it off. Oh, that's cold.
That's good. It's good water. And it's pointless. And he goes, I didn't think about all that. You moron. And then you see that guy lugging that trash like bomb. And he goes, idiot. And he just keeps, he's paddling, just, you know, just all his trash. Just a bunch of morons running around out there.
That's about. I'm getting desperate. Ocean's 11. That was a remake.
Yes.
Billy Ocean wrote, "Get out of my dream. Get in my car."
Yeah.
Ocean spray is what I drink when I have urinary tract infection.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm running out of stuff here. Yeah. So.
All right. We did it.
We did it.
Oceans. It wasn't. You know, was a fun made one. It far.
Yeah.
It
was a fun one.
Made it far. Not as deep as the ocean. I bet there's a lot of stuff we missed. I mean, for us to not know anything. About the ocean. We breezed right over the Bermuda Triangle, which was a much bigger deal.
Uh-huh. I mean, we didn't mention Titanic.
Titanic.
They say there's more artifacts in the ocean than there are in museums.
Yeah, there's more.
How do you...
Well, because that's probably true, because there's more... I mean, there's...
That's a guess, though.
It's... But, I mean, there's been shipwrecks, so you could just say everything that's gone down is an artifact.
Oh, okay.
You know? There's more.
You got a lot of museums, though.
Yeah, but you don't have, you know, there's more change down there. There's more pennies in the ocean than there is in everybody's pocket in the world. And you're like, all right.
You just I'll take your word for it, I guess.
That's probably true. People would lose change all the time on cruise ships. They just dump you. You run a cruise ship, falls in that mattress. You can't get that out of there. Like, and then they just... And then they turn the cruise ship over and everybody leaves and shake all of this, the stuff out of it. And then they flip it back over. That's basically what that guy wants to do with the net. That's what he's thinking with the iceberg and the net. They both go, because you look at that picture, you're like, just grab it and scoop it up and let's be done with it.
Yeah.
Look at that iceberg. That iceberg's right there. Just grab it. Let's move it over here. Same thing. Mm-hmm. All right.
Can I pitch a show?
Oh, yeah.
This Saturday, I'm... at the Body Dayton Church in Dayton, Ohio.
Nice.
And one of our folk, Ryan Voorhees, is going to be opening up. And then,
all right.
So come on out.
Good let our listeners open.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wednesday next. I believe.
He's a comic.
Yeah.
We'll find out.
I mean,
he gives,
I mean,
you got Turler doing a guest spot.
I know. I go.
Nicole's Butcher featuring.
It's going to be a great show.
It's going to be a good show, folks.
I might not be headlining.
Yeah.
Wednesday, August 18th, I'm headlining Zanies here in Nashville. Brian's doing it, too.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
If you want to come see some of the Nate Land.
Yeah.
Crew coming out to Zanies here in Nashville.
Where am I? I'm in Corpus Christi
this weekend.
Come on out and see how this one goes. Could be no one's down there.
Yeah.
But I mean, it'll be fun. All right, that's it.
Yep.
That's it. All right, we will see you next week. Bye.